This video is based on a presentation given to the Venus Forum at the Royal Society of Medicine on Thursday, the 27th of April. It is pitched at a medical audience, but members of the public may find it of interest. Compression after sclerotherapy might seem a rather strange topic for discussion. Surely everyone knows that compression is essential after sclerotherapy. Not much controversy there, you might think, and not much to talk about, really. We have known for over 50 years that compression is essential. Professor George Feagan in the 1960s refined the technique of sclerotherapy for varicose veins and published his experience of treating over 13,000 patients, emphasizing the importance of compression. The term compression sclerotherapy is now embedded in the phlebologist's vocabulary. The rationale for compression is based on Feagan's empty vein technique, thereby reducing superficial and deep vein thrombosis, pain, phlebitis, and bruising. The empty vein technique promotes healing by fibrosis rather than thrombosis, so the efficacy of sclerotherapy is improved and recurrence by neovascularization is reduced. So that's what all vein specialists do now, don't they? Well, I conducted a random poll of phlebologists to ask what their current practice is. It wasn't a scientific survey, and it wasn't sufficiently large to analyse statistically. I posed the question on LinkedIn, and I emailed my professional colleagues. In the UK, certainly among members of the British Association of Sclerotherapists, compression after sclerotherapy is regarded as mandatory, and compression is applied after treatment for any size of vein. Most use compression stockings, some additionally use bandages and eccentric compression. Professor Andrew Bradbury uses bandages and stockings after both microsclerotherapy to reticular veins and telangiectasias and after foam sclerotherapy to varicose veins, to which he additionally applies eccentric compression. Andrew's general comment was, the more compression the better, and other members such as Claire Judge, Julie Halford, Sue Topp, Martin King, Steve Tristram, Chris Latimer and Simon Payne are in agreement. They all use graduated elastic compression stockings with various methods of eccentric compression, with or without additional bandaging. Duration of compression varies, but most feel that 3 to 5 days of continuous compression are needed. Interestingly, Simon Payne places the bandages over the stocking so the patient can remove the bandage without disturbing the stocking. Steve Tristram, for example, uses tourniquets to apply pressure immediately after injection, and he also uses an ingenious method of bubble wrap inside tubigraws for eccentric compression held in place with a pier-haft bandage. Chris Latimer partially applies a thigh-length class 2 graduated elastic compression stocking to the knee, folded back on itself before foam sclerotherapy. He uses eccentric perivenous tumescence for great saphenous sacculations and concentric perivenous tumescence compression occasionally for the entire great saphenous vein to reduce its volume. After sclerotherapy, he uses a thigh-length stocking with waist attachment. Outside the UK, the use of compression after sclerotherapy is far more diverse. For example, some vein specialists use only bandages and no stockings. Some use compression for larger veins, i.e. not for reticular veins or telangiectasias. Some phlebologists use compression selectively and some don't use compression at all. Maurizio Di Giacomo compresses larger veins for 48 hours and only sometimes compresses smaller veins. Zil Yassin uses eccentric compression in addition to a stocking to reduce phlebitis as does Eduardo Toledo de Aguirre. Ricardo Almos Cardenas uses bandages exclusively. Patricia Pave does not use compression at all on small veins, and she uses a combination of bandages and stocking for larger veins. Thomas Eaton offers compression but lets the patient decide. He believes it is unnecessary after any type of sclerotherapy. Finally, these two very influential vein specialists have completely opposite views. Juan Cabrera states that the usefulness of compression after sclerotherapy is beyond doubt, and Jean-Jérôme Gex states that it is useless. So, despite a plethora of various consensus statements and published guidelines from various associations and learned societies, in practice, experts around the world are doing all sorts of different things. So, what does the published data tell us, and can it help us? A much quoted study comes from Hamaldesnos. It looked at 60 patients having foam sclerotherapy to saphenous veins. Half were randomised to a 15 to 20 millimetre of mercury stocking worn during the day for 3 weeks, and half wore nothing. At 28 days, there were no differences in outcome. The study has been criticised for the low compression of the stocking and the relatively high non-compliance rate, but it remains an important and frequently cited publication. This study looked at different bandaging regimes after foam sclerotherapy. It suggested that 24 hours of bandaging is just as effective as 5 days, and given that TED stockings were used, it raises the question whether compression is useful at all. TED stockings, you will recall, are designed for use in patients lying in hospital beds to prevent DVT, and there is some suggestion that they are not effective in the standing position. Kern's study looked at 100 female patients with a lateral thigh vein telangiectasia and reticular veins. After one session of sclerotherapy, half were randomised to a stocking for 3 weeks, and half wore nothing. At 6 weeks, there was no subjective differences in patient satisfaction, no observed differences in matting, staining or microthrombi. The difference in vessel clearance, 63% versus 70%, was very small. If we now turn to the empty vein hypothesis, we know that the work of Hugo Parch shows that very large pressures are required to empty a superficial vein, and that these are very unlikely to be achieved for any length of time with any bandaging technique, let alone a stocking. What about perivenous tumescence? Well, this study suggests that administering tumescent local anaesthetic around a vein to reduce its diameter and to produce local compression does not improve results. And here is an issue that the literature fails to address and which vein specialists rarely discuss. Clearly, the legs on the right are easier to bandage and stockings are more likely to fit. Bandages applied to the lady on the left are likely to either slip down before she reaches home, or they are likely to dig in painfully the next day. I also suggest that it would be very difficult to find a pair of stockings to fit comfortably. Who is at fault if the patient fails to comply with the compression regimen? So, in summary, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I think there is insufficient evidence to convince me to persist with a regimen of firm compression after sclerotherapy, which patients are reluctant to accept for a benefit that is marginal at best. Like many of my colleagues, I now offer compression and let the patient decide whether to wear it and for how long based on how comfortable they feel. Thank you for watching my video.